Bucket list. Who is a bucket list for? Not the young who have decades of life ahead of them and no need to think about what they may have missed. Thank you. Not the elderly who may have the desire to tackle the list but lack the mobility to climb some of the mountains. No, a bucket list is for someone my age. Karen and I do not have a complete bucket list, but we have started one. There are certainly activities we want to do and places we want to see before it is too late. Amazingly, the opportunity to do one of those activities appeared out of nowhere earlier this year. The band U2 announced they would tour the world on the 30th anniversary of their Joshua Tree album. Is that what they're still called? I don't know. Attending a U2 concert was near the top of our bucket list, and they would be playing in Seattle, a destination within our reach. So I bit the bullet, bought the tickets for us, the girls, and a guest for each one. It was only a few weeks later that the cancer diagnosis came. We checked the calendar against the chemotherapy schedule to see if it was still going to be possible. It just worked out that the concert was during the third week of the treatment cycle. We had hoped to take that week off for vacation and do an extensive refreshening project at home, but that wasn't to be. It required too much energy. But we still get to be in Seattle for the concert today. We're excited to spend the weekend with family, future family, and friends, and attend a concert that we all will enjoy. But some of you may be wondering, what is the attraction of U2 for us? For some reason, I lost track of popular music in the 80s. When I picked up following it, one of the first bands I heard was U2. I remember reading an editorial in Christianity Today by Philip Yancey, in which he marveled at the crowds U2 was drawing at their concerts and the popularity of their music among many age groups, but especially among the younger generation. It was energetic music laden with cries for justice in a world gone wrong. It was unique, had a beauty all its own, and spoke to the longings of many. It also was permeated by allusions to the Bible and its message. This was something new in pop music as well. A Christian worldview being communicated, albeit obliquely, but it was there if looked for. So Karen and I began to go back and listen to their earlier music, and we both found it touched us deeply. Since we didn't have a lot of common in our musical tastes, it was nice to find some common ground. So tonight, we are going to be in a crowd of tens of thousands in an outdoor stadium with baby boomers, millennials, and everything in between. Our only regret is that we are missing out on this weekend with you, the tea, the honoring of moms, and the celebration of graduates. You are on our minds and in our hearts. We can't express how much we appreciate your continuing prayers and expressions of love. We are blessed and continue to hope for many more opportunities to work on our bucket list. Okay, would the worship team please come forward?
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, I come to you to share his love as he told me to. He says, freely, freely, you have received. because you believe, others will know that I live. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child.
Let's pray. I am just amazed that I get the privilege to be your child, Father. Lord, we just thank you and praise you that you have gathered us up and adopted us into your family through your blood. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
I'm going to be using this wireless mic today, and you'll understand why in a little bit, but I like to walk around a lot, and so I'll probably walk away from it, and I need you guys to remind me that you know, I need to go back to the mic or do one of these numbers or something like that. So let's open up in prayer if you guys will join me. Father God, thank you for this morning. Thank you. Thank you for our moms. Lord God, that you provided us someone in our lives to love us, to nurture us, to bring us up and raise us up in the values that that they hold dear, Father. And Lord God, I pray for them, for all that's going on in their lives, that you bring them peace and that they can look down and see their children and know that they are loved. And Father God, we look towards you with that same type of love and compassion. And we know that you care for us in ways that not even our mothers could, Father. And we're so grateful for them. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. So, back on to Galatians chapter 5. We've been going over Galatians for quite some time now through somewhat of a foundations class. And if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn open to chapter 5. Now, this is really entertaining to me. It may not be as entertaining to you as it is me, but some pastors literally go decades without teaching on the same passage, doing the same passage twice. But some of you that have been around long enough may remember that in 2011, 2012, somewhere around there, I did pulpit supply for Steve, and I actually went over this exact same passage. And I thought about skipping over it since we'd already done it once. But then I thought, no, it's really important. In fact, it's one of my favorite passages to teach from. And so we're going to go ahead and do it again from a slightly different angle. Some of you, there's an inquisitive expression on Lori's face here. If you remember, I had a fake apple, and we were calling it fruit, fake fruit. And I tossed the apple around for people to try to take a bite out of, but nobody bit. So, we're going to cover it from a slightly different angle this time. I left you last week with a very simple but rather deep question. How are we to understand and act upon grace correctly? If I may summarize a little bit of what we've covered up to this point, we have concluded that as we unpack what we do as Christians and as children of God, that as children of God, we are no longer slaves, but free. Just as we sang, we are no longer slaves to fear. We are no longer slaves to sin, to the power of sin. We are free. In this very expensive freedom that was purchased for us on the cross and given to us through grace, we have the responsibility to use that freedom to serve one another humbly in love rather than indulging the flesh. And that's what we went through in the first half of Galatians 5. And so acting upon grace is placing the physical, emotional, and spiritual needs of others higher than our own. Paul calls us to love others in humility. And humility, as we know, is placing others more important, is placing ourselves less important. Now, it's not thinking less of ourselves. It's thinking of ourselves less often. And we're called to do that when we love one another. So what else? What else do we do biblically to act upon grace? It seems like an oxymoron because there is no grace plus. Grace is all we need to be forgiven. Grace is all we need to be justified. But there's more to a Christian's life than merely being justified. Now that sounds scandalous, but let me pick your mind for a moment. And this is what we're going to unpack today. So let's go ahead and read Galatians 5 together if you have it open. We're going to start in verses 16, and we'll read through the end of the chapter. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with one another, so that you are not to do whatever you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying one another. Okay. right off the bat, we get the answer to our question, how do we act upon this grace? What do we do with this grace? Right off the bat, it says, you, my brothers and sisters, excuse me. There we go. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. That's a little better. I don't know why I chose my little Bible today. I usually have a giant Bible to where I can see from, but I don't like my glasses, so I try not to have to wear them. Walk by the Spirit. Instant answer. It's simple, right? Just walk by the Spirit. That's what the Bible tells us to do. What does that mean? Does anybody know what that means, to walk by the Spirit? How exactly do we go about doing that? Well, he explains it to us here in just a moment. In verse 17, he says, for the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you wish. Do not do whatever you wish. This goes to affirm what we already know, that God didn't grant us freedom of sin and from the law just so that we could do anything we feel like. We have that grace in place if we make a mistake. And Paul even goes to talk about, which we talked about last week, that there are times when we exploit that grace for selfish indulgences or selfish desires, but that is not our purpose. We have a purpose. That freedom that was given to us was for a purpose that deeply involves a relationship with the Holy Spirit. Walk by the Spirit. Okay? Verse 18 says, but you are led by the Spirit. If you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now, that seems kind of like a no-brainer, but I actually like to read that backwards. And this is very interesting to me. Okay, if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Read it backwards, and it says this: when you are under the law, you cannot be led by the Spirit. Okay? We've talked about this weeks and weeks and weeks. That being under the law is this whole idea of taking back control from God. That we are going to earn our way into God's grace. That we are going to have control over our lives, and we'll let God have it back whenever we feel like it. Last week we talked about an analogy of a special cruise control that I used to work with, and how people would hover with their foot over the brake pedal. And that's exactly what this is like. We hover with our foot over the brake pedal, ready to take back control over our life, over our salvation, thinking that we actually have some type of input into it, when in all actuality we don't. Being under the law is taking on the responsibility of doing everything under the law, doing X, Y, and Z so that I can get salvation, doing X, Y, and Z so that I can be close to God, when all of that was already done on the cross. And so to be under the law says we cannot be led by the Spirit. And I don't know about you, but I would much rather be led by the Spirit than have to try and live, to try to achieve this perfection of being under the law. I would much rather have God living through me, through his Holy Spirit, than trying to do this on my own. Okay? And so right then and there, just that little verse alone should make you like just totally rethink how you are looking at your perspective at your salvation, your relationship with the Lord. Because if you are trying to earn it, if you're trying to do better, try harder, sin less, then you are not allowing the Spirit to lead your life. And if you're not allowing the Spirit to lead your life, then who's in control? Then who is God in your life? It leads to an interesting question. It's one to ponder, one to spend some time thinking about. Verse 19, the acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. All of these acts of flesh, or perhaps fruits of the flesh, are immoral. They're unethical things. Even most secular folks, even most atheists will agree that that list there are very terrible, immoral, unethical things. But oddly enough, we as believers, as followers of Christ, have a temptation to elevate them higher than minor sin. Little white lies. Maybe driving 5 miles an hour over the speed limit. Maybe taking a tax exemption that you kind of half deserve, but don't really, but you're going to take it anyway. Those quote-unquote little sins. But I want to remind, just as Paul reminds, that sin is sin. Sin, as its roots, is dependence, or independence, excuse me. Dependence on self is defiance of God. Dependence of self is defiance of God. When we want to be independent from God, when we want to do things our way, when we don't like God's plan, when we don't like God's purpose, we say, no, God, you can have this part of my life, but I'm gonna hold on to this light. I'm going to hold on to this part. I'm going to be independent of you on this part. That is sin. And it's no worse and no better than genocide. Sin is sin. And so when we read through this list and we have a temptation to have a little pen and go, I haven't done that, I haven't done that, I haven't done that, it doesn't matter. If you have told one lie, if you have stole one item, if you have gone 1 mile per hour over the speed limit, you have sinned because you have defied the purpose that God has for you. Okay? Now, the important part, one that everybody has questions about. People who live like this, you're thinking, oh no, oh no. I'm a Christian, and last week I went like 3 miles an hour over the speed limit. I live like that. I am in trouble. What am I to do now? Well, that's interesting because if we remember back when Paul says to live as Christ and to die as gain, how do we live as Christ? We're identified as being known with Christ. It's part of who we are. It's part of our identity. And for people who live like this, who live this kind of lifestyle, who are indwelled, I'm not sure if that's the right word, but enveloped by this kind of lifestyle, they live that way because that is who they are. There is no other identity to who they are than the sin that envelops them. Now, for a Christian, our identity is in something else, and we're going to talk about that here in a moment. A Christian may accidentally, or maybe even purposely, fall into one of these. But the consequences for that sin, as we've talked about in the past, have already been met on the cross. They were already taken to the cross 2,000 years ago. They don't live that way. Every once in a while, they act that way. And there's a big difference, action and identity. Okay. So those who live this way, those who live in this list of the fruits of the flesh, they may feel the social ramifications of things like theft and adultery, as there are, as we talked about. There are earthly consequences, social consequences, but they do not fear the eternal consequences. They don't understand the eternal consequences. And this is what it means to live like that. It is a living a life with no fear of who God is, no fear of the consequences for a life lived under this fruit of the flesh. And so when we read this and we fear that we might be living that way, if you have Christ in you, if you've invited Christ into your life, then you have no reason to fear. There is no consequences for those who are in Christ. Okay. Of course, Christians recognize that they need to abstain from these things. These aren't good things. These are unethical, immoral things. We are to reject these fruits of the flesh. But we realize that we can't do that ourselves, right? We don't have the power to reject some of this temptation. So how does a Christian reject the power of the flesh? This is where it gets cool. Verses 22 through 24. But the fruit of the Spirit, is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Spiritual fruit becomes the tool to reject the power of the flesh. Spiritual fruit becomes the tool to reject the power of the flesh. It's only through the power of the Holy Spirit that we're able to do so. We cannot do it in and of ourselves. We not only reject them, we crucify them. We lay them at the feet of Jesus and let him take them to the cross. Joy. Joy becomes the defeater of envy and hatred. When you are truly joyful for what you have, truly thankful, truly excited, and just overjoyed by what God has done for you in your life, I am going to go out on a limb and say that it is impossible for you to envy and hate someone else. Because if you have true joy in your heart, those things don't matter anymore. Whatever's causing you to be envious, whatever's causing you to hate. Love. The spiritual fruit of love becomes the defeater of jealousy and selfishness. Remember that hate is not the opposite of love, but selfishness is, because love is selfless. And so when we truly love someone, it is almost impossible to be selfish. When we truly love someone, it's almost impossible to be jealous of that person and to want to be that person, because we're happy with who we are and we're happy with who they are. Faith and self-control smash idolatry and discord. And the list goes on. As these spiritual fruits are acquired into our lives, they give us the tools to reject fruits of the flesh. Does that make sense? So there's one more very, very important point to Paul's message. Probably the greatest point of all. Right? And it's one that can probably be better shown than taught. So I'm going to try and do this the best I can. Too often we read through our Bibles. We read with the idea of what do I need to do, which is exactly what we're doing now. We're reading with what do I need to do, and we come across verses like Galatians 5, books like Galatians 5 and the verses of the spiritual fruit, and we think, that's what I need. I've got to have that. Okay? And so I'm going to do a depiction of what that might look like. So you'll have to forgive me. I have definitely have clothes underneath here. Hello. I'm Kip. If you can read my name up here is Kip, and just so you know, I'm a sinner. You know, I don't know Jesus. In fact, I'm destined for honestly a very, very hot place someday, and I worship a God that I may not realize yet, but I will someday over here. And in my life, I really don't, you know, care about what happens eternally. I'm just kind of in it for the here and the now, and these things flow out of who I am. Immorality, you know, lying, sin. Fruits of the flesh roll out of my life. And I'm kind of happy. I'm happy how my life is going because I get to do whatever I want. And I don't have to worry about the consequences of it. Okay. So time goes by for Kip. And he starts to wonder, you know, is this all that life is? And someone comes and shares with Kip what the gospel is. And Kip doesn't think about it too much, but a seed gets planted, and it starts to grow. And Kip starts to wonder, maybe there is more to this life. Maybe this fruit of the flesh that has come out of him is just, you know, just hurting him rather than helping him. And so in one moment, he finally chooses to invite Christ into his heart. Okay, hi, I'm Kip. That's me. I'm no longer a sinner. I no longer have all this consequences of all this fruit of the flesh weighing me down. Life is good because I know Jesus, and I am happy that I know Jesus, and I feel freer, I feel cooler. I feel that freedom going on here. Life is good. And I start attending church. and I start hanging out at Bible studies and hanging out with guys who know Jesus. And I start reading my Bible, and I'm going through it, and I'm saying, you know, there's a lot of this stuff going on in the Bible that I don't do. Maybe I should be doing some of these things. And it just so happens I went to church one day, and this really handsome pastor started talking about spiritual fruit. And I need me some of that. And so I go through Galatians chapter 5, and I start reading down, and I get down to verse 22, and it says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. I need some love, joy, and peace in my life. And so I start looking around. That one looks like it's been through a plane crash. Look, I found a shirt. It says love, joy, and peace on it. And so I get off the rack, and I'm excited. Check. Whoa. Check it out. I have love, joy, and peace in my life now. How cool is that? Look at me. I love, I have joy, I'm at peace, life is good, I must be a super Christian. Do you see this? This is so cool, but, they didn't spell my name right. It's okay, you guys know who I am, I'm Kip, right? Right? But it doesn't matter who I am, because I've got love, I've got joy, and I got peace in my life, and life is good, and I'm doing great, and I feel so much more spiritual. Whew, I'm doing what the Bible tells me to do. So I'm going to wander back over here to the Bible. And look, it's not just love, joy, and peace. It's also patience, kindness, and goodness. I'm not done yet. So I get back over here to the rack. Look, I found one. It says patience, kindness, goodness. This is great. I'm gonna put this one on too. All right, I don't know about you, but I am doing pretty awesome right now. I am the cat's meow because now, not only do I have love and patience, excuse me, I don't memorize stuff very well, love, joy, and patience, I have kindness, and I have goodness, and I'm doing awesome. I am a spiritual superstar because I have all these spiritual fruits coming out of me right now, and I've got them on, and I feel strong, and I'm feeling a little warm right now, and maybe little you know, stuck here, and they keep getting more of my name wrong. I guess I'm kind of ip. Maybe just P. I don't know. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who I am, because I got this spiritual fruit on me, and this is good. And people are looking at me, and they're seeing all the spiritual fruit, and they're knowing, they know that I'm a Christian. Because that's what it's about. That I am living out the Bible because it says in here that, you know, I need to have spiritual fruit, and so I just put them on, and life is good. And, there's more? Gentleness, self-control. Well, let's go back to the rack. Well, okay, there's more. It says faith, gentleness, and self-control. So, okay, I guess I'm not done here. Let's put another one on. All right, I have got this. I am classified super saint right now. I have got every single one of the spiritual fruit on me. I am doing awesome. I have got it all figured out. I have gone through the Bible. I have put it on. You may worship me now. But here's something interesting. My name's completely gone. And I, for the life of me, I can't remember what my name is. Do you guys? It's getting harder to remember who I really am because, I don't know about you, but I'm really feeling restricted, and it's kind of hot, but I'm doing what the Bible says, so that's important. That's important, but I don't know. I don't know if this is right. I mean, it says in the Bible I need to do these things, but I don't completely understand why I don't feel free, even though I've got all this fruit on. And so Kip spends a certain amount of time trying to figure this out. Kip doesn't understand why he's doing what the Bible says, but he actually feels more restricted. He feels less free. He feels less closer to God because he's doing what the Bible says. And so finally, in an act of something, in desperation, Kip decides, you know what, putting on these shirts, it was a mistake. And so he starts taking them back off. As he begins to take these off, he feels lighter, more freedom. To where he's back to where he was. He is Kip. And Kip no longer sins, but now Kip doesn't have any of the beautiful fruit coming out of him that was before, but there's freedom in it. He feels freer. It's a little bit cooler. But he's completely and totally lost at what he's supposed to do. I mean, we've got all this grace. We've got all this freedom. We need to do something with it. Don't understand. Is this on? Okay. Don't understand why. Why do I feel this way? And so finally, after God has been working on Kip's heart for years and years and years, Kip surrenders. Kip says, God, I don't know what to do. I don't know what you want done with me. I cannot do this on my own. I have tried. I have failed. Whatever I do, it does not feel like freedom. God, I need you to take over me. I need you to fill me, Lord. Help me to live. I mean, just live through me. God, I'm done trying this on my own. And finally, God goes, yes, he gets it. He gets it. And the final onion layer gets pulled off. Sorry for the belly shot. And he get down to his real, true, and godly identity and purpose. And he is no longer Kip. He is Christ in Kip, which is our true identity, our true purpose from the very beginning. And out of this identity, out of who we are in Christ, we begin to grow something. Something begins to grow within us and be produced in us. And as it begins to grow, we realize it's all that spiritual fruit that we tried to pick ourselves, that we tried to put on ourselves and act out and do, that kept us from experiencing true freedom. And yet when Kip realized that it was produced by the Spirit that already lived in him, if he allowed that Spirit to work within him, that they would grow automatically and it would be much more freer. And believe me, it's so much more cooler in here. I think we have some mic issues going on here. It's much more cooler in here without 19 shirts on, so it was very warm earlier. Verse 25. Verse 25 says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us keep in step with the Spirit. To be in step with it is to be filled by, to be controlled by, to submit to. It is dependence. It is complete and total dependence on the Spirit. A giving over of ourselves. A giving up of who we think we are. And a giving over to who God is. And allowing him to live through us. When we submit to the Spirit, when we keep in step with the Spirit, we let God live through us. He becomes our identity. Christ becomes our identity. And only through then did the spiritual fruit begin to grow. Spiritual fruit can only be grown. It cannot be picked. We tried to pick it. It didn't work. So finally, in verse 26 says, let us not become conceited, provoking and envying one another. Is there room for envy and arrogance in the body of Christ? There is no competitive fruit-growing contests in the church, although we try. Let us, as we grow towards our identity in Christ, as we bud out and slowly begin the process of growing these spiritual fruit, let us be reminded of the purpose, of our purpose, individually and as a body, as a church. We are here to glorify our Creator in word or in doctrine, in song, worship, in speech, and finally, in action, in what we do. Let's start today. Let's ask the Holy Spirit through prayer to help us grow these promised fruits within our lives so that we may, in return, use them to glorify our Creator and our Savior and our Heavenly Father. Shall we pray? Father God, Lord, we do just, our heartfelt desire is to humbly submit before you, Father, to give ourselves over to you. Lord, that we can reject all that's in us that cries out me. And Lord, that we can give it to you and allow you to be Christ in us. Father, whatever plan, whatever purpose you have for us, God, Father, I pray that you convict us to allow you to work that through us, Father, that we don't try and take control, that we don't try to take back the wheel from you, Lord, but that we give it over to you completely. Lord, I pray as we read your word that we read it with the right eyes, eyes that don't look to puff us ourselves up in arrogance and envy, but, Lord, eyes that want to bring you glory, that stir our hearts to know you deeply, Father, and to grow that relationship with your Spirit. Lord, I thank you for your Son. I thank you for sending him to the cross for us, God, that each of us may know you intimately through him and through your Spirit. Father God, I pray as we spend some time worshiping you, Father, that, Lord God, you would help us place all of our anxieties, all of our concerns aside right now and just come before you on our knees, Lord. God, we love you and we thank you, Father. In your name we pray. Amen.
When I think about walking with the Spirit and God's Spirit in me, I think about starting the day with an invitation to the Spirit to just infiltrate my day and my life and my heart and my world. It's just that reminder that each and every day is a new day, and that Christ in me is there because I've accepted him. But each and every day, I need to just re-invite the Spirit to take over my life and to direct my day. So let's just do that in song right now.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord.
Will you stand with us?
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen
of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Thus become more aware of your presence. Experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
Amen. Thank you.
be seated.
He does. The Lord, He lifts me with His strong arms. Oh, yes, He does.